So, this study, hopefully, is going to go a little bit quicker than the hour-long Bible studies that I've been putting out recently. So, this is not going to get into all of them, but there's some names of God found in the scriptures that speak to his character, what he did at the time, whatever covenant it was, or whatever deed he performed for his people. So, these speak also to what God is willing to do. So it speaks to his character, and so I've even heard it often through the years. Like in matters of healing, well, if God is willing, then otherwise this must be his will. Well, God doesn't will for his people to be sick. He lifts the heavy burden, he sets his people free. And if you're a child of God and you're seeking after him, it's his will that you be healthy, whole, healed. Jesus went around healing all the sick and casting out devils. And so that's what I see in scriptures. He didn't leave people afflicted behind him when he moved through a place. He went through, he healed the sick. He cast out devils, he performed miracles. And so it's like with one of the prophets, there was some Syrian widow that I think it might have been Elijah, that he was fed by ravens during a time of famine, and then he went to this the house of this widow and performed a miracle of provision for the person. Israel would not receive him. And then I think it's Elijah also that told Naaman the Syrian to go dip in the Jordan. And he was actually, even though he threw a fuss about it at first, he went and did as he was told and he was healed, even though there were many lepers in Israel at the time. And Jesus even like pointed this out to his own people when he walked the earth, and they did not receive him. They wanted to throw him off a hilltop. So some names of God are used in the title and description here. The I am Yahweh, the self-existent one, that's Exodus chapter 3, verses 14 to 15. Elohim, the Godhead three in one, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, all together in Genesis chapter 1. So, the God who sees, Genesis chapter 16, verses 13 to 14, there is nothing hidden from him. He sees right through people, as Jesus demonstrated. He knew the reasonings in the people's hearts. And he often pointed this out. So, Exodus 3. Exodus chapter 3, verses 14 to 15. Exodus chapter 3, verses 14 to 15. This is why discerning of spirits is a gift listed in the scriptures. Because God can see what is in a person, he can see the motives. So, I gotta check the live stream here just to make sure that it's functioning. So, he knows what's in you. Verses 14 to 15. Okay, the NLT doesn't really say this. Must be some interesting translation that was on. I use the NLT, the King James Version, and the New American Standard Bible. These have easily understood translations of the scriptures. Okay, this just speaks to God saying that he's the I am again. So I'm not sure where this, what the translation was here. Always good to do research beforehand if you're booked back to back. Kind of makes it interesting. Although, El Shaddai, the all-sufficient one, this is Genesis chapter 17, verses 1 to 2. I often use Bible apps, use the internet, quickly checking things with the Bible app. You type in what you see on the internet, it's like the God who sees, and it will present that if that is a translation used somewhere in some translation. Although it doesn't match the three translations of the Bible I like to use, so I can't really go on this in depth. So, El Shaddai, Genesis chapter 17, verses 1 to 2. When Abraham was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am El Shaddai, God Almighty. Serve me faithfully and live a blameless life, and I will make a covenant with you by which I will guarantee to give you countless descendants. This being the NLT, the New Living Translation. So, at this, Abram fell down on the ground. God said to him, this is my covenant with you. I will make you the father of many nations. What's more, I am changing your name. You'll no longer be Abram. Instead, you will be called Abraham, for you will be the father of many nations. I will make you extremely fruitful. Your descendants will become many nations, and kings will be among them. I will confirm my covenant with you and your descendants after you from generation to generation. This is the everlasting covenant. I will always be your God and the God of your descendants after you, and I will give you the entire land of Canaan, where you will live as a foreigner, you and your descendants. It will be for their possession forever, and I will be their God. So it gets into circumcision as part of the covenant. Sarai's name gets changed to Sarah. And he says, I will bless her and give you a son from her. Yes, I will bless her richly. She'll become the mother of many nations. Kings of nations will be among her descendants. Then he tells him later on in this chapter, my covenant will be confirmed with Isaac. And then it continues on in Genesis chapter 22. God tests Abraham, and he passes the test. This is where he was told to sacrifice his son Isaac, and so he goes to do so. But he looks up and sees, after an angel stops him, he sees a ram caught by its horns nearby. And so this is after Isaac, on the way there, asks Abraham, Where's the sacrificial animal? I forget if it was like a ram or a sheep that they were supposed to bring. But Abraham tells him God will provide one. And so he did. And so the angel of the Lord says to Abraham from heaven, this is what the Lord says, because you have obeyed me and have not withheld even your son, your only son, I swear by my own name, I will certainly bless you. I will multiply your descendants beyond number, like stars in the sky and sand on the seashore. Your descendants will conquer the cities of their enemies, and through your descendants all the nations of the earth will be blessed, all because you have obeyed me. And so, one of these translations also speaks to how Abraham was told, those who bless you, I will bless, those who curse you, I will curse. And what this gets into regarding this lesson and the character of God, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That's Hebrews chapter 13, verse 8. In Galatians chapter 3, the Galatian church was being corrected by the Apostle Paul on matters of doctrine. And the church are the sons of Abraham when they are doers of the word, not just hearers, but actually doing what the Bible instructs. They are grafted into that olive tree, which is Israel. They are branches of the true vine, who is Jesus, and Jesus is the root of David. And so those who are the New Testament church filled with the Holy Spirit are actually the children of Abraham. And Jesus even says this to the hearers. And I've actually heard that it's, well, people try to talk it down like it's just mere allegory. Well, Jesus spoke an allegory, but it was also truth. He is the Word of God, and what he says is. God speaks, and it is. God sits on his throne and speaks, and his words come to pass. Isaiah 55 tells us this, and so does Jesus. He is the way and the truth and the life. No one comes unto the Father but through him. And he commanded things, he spoke to them, and they obeyed. And so, the Proverbs. People try to talk down the Proverbs, but the Proverbs are the words of God. They are his wisdom, and they are visibly demonstrated in the world. So, this is a name of God that can be trusted in. And then El Olam, the everlasting God, the eternal God. This is how Abraham described God. And Jehovah Jireh, or Jireh, or Jireh, or however you pronounce it, the Lord will provide. Genesis chapter 22, verses 13 to 14. Being a millennial who grew up in the modern education system here in Orleans County, New York, it's like a lot of these words I can't pronounce, but I'll put the effort forward. So, Genesis chapter 22, verses 13 and 14. Then Abraham looked up, saw a ram caught by its horns in a thicket, so he took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering in the place of his son. Abraham called the place Jehovah Jireh, which means the Lord will provide. To this day, people still use the name as a proverb, on the mountain of the Lord it will be provided. And Jesus is the stone that the builders rejected that has become the head of the corner. On this rock I will build my church. And so, he is the Father. He and his Father are one. John chapter 10, verse 30. And then later on in the Gospel of John, Jesus tells his people he has to ascend back up to the Father so that he can send his Holy Spirit to come and dwell with all the believers. The Spirit of the Father. So you have the Godhead right there again. So, and God is Spirit. Adonai, the Lord and Master, that's Psalm 16, verse 2. And I've heard that before in like songs, like a popular one by Paul Baloch, or Baloch, or however you pronounce his name. Praise Adonai. There's the Lord who heals, Jehovah Rapha, Exodus chapter 15, verse 26. He said, if you will listen carefully to the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his sight, obeying his commands and keeping all his decrees, then I will not make you suffer any of the diseases I set on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you. I am the Lord who heals you. That's another way of saying it. And in the Gospels, there was a leper who approached Jesus, asking him, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. And Jesus, reaching out to touch him, said, I am willing, be clean. And so the leper was cleansed. And Jesus, who is God, God the Son, God the Father, by his own very words, he is willing to heal all who come to him. So, Jehovah Nissi, the Lord my banner, that's Exodus chapter 17, verse 15. And here's another one. God, who calls himself jealous, Exodus 34, verse 14. Jealous for his people. And this is why he was so moved to intervene when his people would turn from him, as demonstrated over and over in biblical history. He is jealous for his people because his people, with the way he made them and what he intends, they are his children. And so he is their protector, their provider, God the Father. The father of his people. But whenever he, let's see, just got to be sure I'm on the right one. Verse 14. So I'm way past it here. Verse 14. Starting in verse 12, God speaking to his people, giving them instructions. Be very careful never to make a treaty with the people who live in the land where you are going. If you do, you will follow their evil ways and be trapped. Instead, you must break down their pagan altars, smash their sacred pillars, cut down their Asherim poles, destroy their idols. You must worship no other gods, for the Lord, whose very name is Jealous, is a God who is jealous about his relationship with you. Do not make a treaty of any kind with the people living in the land. They lust after other things. They pursue other gods. They sacrifice to them. They'll invite you to join them in their iniquity, in their wicked ways, in their sacrificial meals, and you'll go after them. Then you'll accept their daughters who sacrifice to other gods as wives for your sons, and they will seduce your sons to commit adultery against me by worshiping other gods. You must not make any gods of molten metal for yourselves. You must celebrate the festival of unleavened bread. For 7 days, the bread you eat must be made without yeast, just as I commanded you. Celebrate this festival annually at the appointed time in the early spring in the month of Abib, for that is the anniversary of your departure from Egypt. The firstborn of every animal belongs to me, including the firstborn males from your herds of your cattle, the flocks of your sheep and goats. A firstborn donkey may be brought back from the Lord by presenting a lamb or a young goat in its place, but if you do not buy it back, you must break its neck. However, you must buy back every firstborn son. No one may appear before me without an offering. You have 6 days each week for your ordinary work, but on the seventh day you must stop working, even during the seasons of plowing and harvest. You must celebrate the festival of harvest with the first crop of the wheat harvest and celebrate the festival of the final harvest at the end of the harvest season. Then he goes on through his appointed feasts, his statutes, his ordinances to keep Israel from sinning with wicked nations. And this is also pointing to tithing, giving the best, the tenth, but also first fruits is another kind of offering, that the harvest of whatever you do also be greatly blessed. And then at the end of it, there's another offering there that's described. There's many kinds of offerings in the Bible, and Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And I've actually seen how many of these still bring blessing when they're followed through on. So, Jonathan Shuttlesworth speaks on this. He sows all kinds of offerings and has seen legit, valid fruit in his ministry because of it. So, when you actually do what the Bible instructs, you're going to see the result described. And so, these names on this list that I have here, over 30 names of God, all describing his character, which is still who he is. So, Jehovah Shalom, the Lord our peace. Judges chapter 6, verse 24. Here's another interesting one. Again, the Lord my shield. Psalm 3, verse 3. And these, taking like what David says in the Psalms and finding the Hebrew word for it. And it's like in the New Testament, in John, I think it's John chapter 10, Christ, the door of the sheepfold. Ask, seek, knock, and you will find, you'll receive, you'll find, it will be opened unto you. And this speaks to God Almighty. Jesus says he and his Father are one. Christ, the door of the sheepfold. Basically, if you want to enter into things, you have to go through him for him to bless it. So, these that have been gone over here basically address the main points that I've heard through the years concerning God's character, what he's willing or not willing to do, but the scriptures show that God is willing to take care of his people, to provide for them, to make sure they're in great health. He is their healer, and he's the door of the sheepfold. You seek him as far as what to do with your life, what to get into, what to stay out of. He'll give you his counsel in these things. And so you have to draw near to him for him to draw near to you. You have to go into your prayer closet, as I've heard it said, shut out all distractions, and spend time in his presence. Pray in the spirit. This will build up your spirit, man. Fast. That way the flesh is out of the way. And long-term fasting is a great thing to do if you can. And no food. And the flesh is going to throw a fit within the first few days, but after that, it'll level off. It'll get out of the way, and you'll be able to focus on the voice of God. And if you combine giving with that, you're going to see great results. And it's a three-strand cord that will be hard to break. And God keeps his word. He is the truth. It doesn't return unto him empty. And what's written in the Bible, you can stand upon. You can trust that more than anything else in the world. And so, for those of you who don't yet know Jesus, he does awesome things with his people. And just in general, he gives them peace. He gives them joy. And things really are different with him. He gives his people great favor, even regarding matters of work, dealing with people, and situations turn around far easier than living without him. And so I've seen this myself, and things get better and better, even year by year. I see increase in my life, not decrease. I move forward in God's plan and purpose. I move forward in the work that I do. It gets better and better, even despite other people's efforts to try to shut me out, kick me out, whatever. And I'm blessed, and it's going to be getting better. So the same can happen with you if you choose him. And God can use you for his purposes, for building his kingdom also. And what are the children of God called to? The Gospels and the Epistles point to that. Although, to start with, you need Jesus. And all people in the world, all who get born into the world, are under sin. All fall short of the glory of God. There's no one exempt from this. I've even had to do this. And so, the thief comes to steal, to kill, to destroy, but Jesus came that people who choose him will have life and life abundantly. And whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. The wages of sin is death. The free gift of God is eternal life through his son, Jesus. And so, you are a whosoever, so I'm going to say a quick prayer for you. Lord, bless these people with long and healthy lives. Do a quick work in their hearts that if they did not receive you, Lord, I pray that they will do so now. So, repeat after me, all of you. Dear Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive me of my sin. Wash me and cleanse me. Set me free. Jesus, thank you that you died for me. I believe that you are risen from the dead and that you're coming back again for me. Fill me with the Holy Spirit. Give me a passion for the lost, a hunger for the things of God, and a holy boldness to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm saved, I'm born again, I'm forgiven, and I'm on my way to heaven because I have Jesus in my heart. So as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, I tell you today that your sins are forgiven, and always remember to run to God, not from him, because he loves you. He has an awesome plan for your life.